What's going on, everyone? This is Kevin here from Smartphone Review Pro. And in this video, we're going to be going over Samsung Galaxy A42 5G pros and cons. So join me as we go over the various pros and cons and best and worst things about this phone. Let's start by going over the 5 best things, and then after that, we'll go over the 5 worst things. Now, I do want to be clear, the worst things about this phone are a bit of nitpicking, but there are some things that I do want to point out just in case they happen to be important to you. But let's go over the 5 pros. So starting off at number 1, and that is the battery capacity. So with the Samsung Galaxy A42 5G, we have a massive 5,000, yes, you heard that right, 5,000 milliamp hour internal battery. So a very large battery with this phone, but despite the battery being so large, the device feels decently light, and it also isn't too thick. But there are more benefits with having a massive internal battery than you might think. The first benefit is pretty obvious. You're going to be getting better battery life with the phone. But the second benefit of having a very large battery like this is that the lifespan of this phone is going to be a bit longer. I'm not sure about you specifically, but I know for me, oftentimes I end up upgrading phones mostly because the device can't hold a charge anymore. Now, it doesn't matter what device you get, batteries are gonna degrade as time goes on, and they are gonna be less effective. However, that is less noticeable when you have a very oversized battery to start with. So for this phone, for example, if after several years, it can only hold like a 70 or 80% charge, you're not gonna notice that nearly as much as you would with a phone that has a much smaller battery. That's why with iPhones especially, it's extremely noticeable when the phone can't hold a charge as much, because with those devices, they already start with a really tiny battery. So again, just to clarify, it doesn't matter what phone you get, the battery will degrade and will be able to hold less and less of a full charge as time goes on. But getting a phone like this, where you're starting off with a battery that's really massive as it is certainly gonna set you up for a better experience long term. Now, the second pro with the Samsung Galaxy A42 5G is the amount of internal storage that you get. Now, this particular variant of the phone features 128 gigs of storage, and if that's not enough for you, it does also support microSD card expansion. But as apps get bigger and bigger, as they have been throughout the last decade, you're gonna need more and more internal storage. I remember it wasn't too long ago where having 32 gigs of internal storage was plenty of storage. But nowadays, 32 gigs is definitely not enough, and for many people out there, 64 gigs might not be ample either. So considering that you're getting 128 gigs of internal storage with this phone, even though it's not a really high-end device compared to some of the various flagships out there, really makes this phone a good value. In fact, something that's especially funny is that the iPhone 12, a brand new smartphone, a brand new flagship smartphone, might I add, only comes with 64 gigs of internal storage for the base model. So the fact that you can get this for far less money and you're getting far more storage really shows you how much extra value Samsung is giving us here with the A42 5G. My third favorite thing about the Samsung Galaxy A42 5G definitely has to be the cameras. Now, with this device, we are getting a quad camera setup on the rear of the phone. We're also getting a 20 megapixel front-facing camera as well, so we do get a lot of different abilities here. Now, as far as the quad camera setup goes, we have a 48 megapixel main camera, an 8 megapixel ultra-wide-angle camera at 123 degrees, we have a 5 megapixel depth-sensing camera, and a 5 megapixel macro camera for close-up, high-quality images. And then with this setup, we're getting portrait mode with both the rear and front cameras on this phone. Now, here's how things look with the main camera on the phone. Then from here, we can switch over to the ultra wide angle camera to fit a lot more content into the frame. We can also go over to the more tab to access the live focus mode. So we get those nice blurred out backgrounds. We can also go to the more tab and access the macro camera. So again, we can get very close up here, but have things be in very good detail. We can switch around to the front facing camera. And we do have an option here for a wider front-facing mode. So if you are taking a group selfie, that does come in handy. We can also do live focus portrait mode for the front camera as well. So you really do get a lot of different options and abilities with the cameras on this phone, despite this being an upper mid-range device. Now, definitely compared to flagship phones out there, like the S20 Ultra, the Note 20 Ultra, and the iPhone 12, the cameras on this device are not going to be quite as good, but you wouldn't expect that either because this phone is not a flagship. Now, in my full review video, I will have a deeper analysis of the photo and video quality from this device, but here are a couple of pictures that I did take yesterday, and you can see for this front-facing portrait mode selfie, we have a nice blurred out background, and then with me being the subject in the photo, things are in very good focus here. So that was definitely a very good picture that I was able to take with the phone. Here's a picture that I took with the main camera, and again, very good detail all throughout. The device did a very good job of capturing this picture as well, really bringing a lot of detail out of the things that are in the foreground, while also blurring out the background, giving us very good depth of field. So in general, I am very happy and impressed with the camera quality from this phone. Now, as far as video goes, that was also a very good experience. Again, I'll be putting all of that in my full review of this device that will be out in the future, so certainly make sure to sub. But you get 4K video at 30 FPS with the rear camera and 1080p video at 30 FPS with the front camera. Now moving on to number 4, and that is the processor. Now with the Galaxy A42 5G, we're getting the Qualcomm Snapdragon 750 5G processor. So that's a relatively new processor from Qualcomm, and I've been very happy with the performance so far. Navigating around the phone is very smooth. That's not an issue at all. I do want to do some deeper testing between now and the review video. So again, stay tuned for a deeper analysis in the review, but so far so good. Now this particular variant of the A42 5G does come with 6 GB of RAM, so that's really nice as well. So combining 6 GB of RAM with the Snapdragon 750 5G is gonna give you impressive performance. Now I did run a benchmark test using the Geekbench 5 benchmark app, and I got a single core score of 658 and a multi-core score of 2009. So what I recommend doing is installing Geekbench 5 on your current phone and then compare your scores to these scores here to see what kind of performance upgrade you should expect from this device. Now again, to clarify, there are a lot of things about this phone that I really do like, and these are just my top 5 favorite things. But coming in at number 5 is the in-display fingerprint sensor. So this phone does feature an in-display fingerprint sensor, and it does work nice and quickly and reliably, so I am happy with it. Now in addition to having that, the device also features face unlock, so there are a variety of different methods to getting into the phone. But now that we've gone over my 5 pros about the Samsung Galaxy A42 5G, we're now going to go over my 5 cons or least favorite things about the device. Now again, to clarify, these are more nitpicking because I do think the phone is a good value overall, but these 5 things that I'm about to go over are things that I would like to potentially see addressed in the replacement of this phone. The first con about the A42 5G is that we have a water drop notch at the top of the phone. Now, notches were first introduced, I believe, in late 2017, 2018, but for the majority of Galaxy A series devices, there weren't any notches in 2020. In fact, the Galaxy A51, which was launched in December of 2019, did not have a water drop notch. That phone instead had a hole punch for the front-facing camera. And even lower-end phones like the A11, A21, A21S, all of those devices had hole punches for the front-facing camera as well. So I'm really not sure why Samsung decided to give the A42 a water drop notch. I'd imagine the main reason is to save money. So is it a deal breaker? No. However, I would have liked to see a hole punch instead. Now moving on to the next thing about this phone that I wish was better, and that is the display. Now let me clarify, the display on this phone is not a bad display. However, it is a bit disappointing that the A42 5G has a 720p display. I'll give them credit for giving us Super AMOLED here, because in general, the display does look nice. But when you look at the display, you can pretty easily tell that it is 720p, and it's not 1080p. And if it was 1080p, I think that would have made a very big difference and would have made things definitely a lot better. Now, just like the notch situation, is having a 720p display on this phone a deal breaker? I mean, definitely not. I don't think it is. However, if this phone had 1080p instead of 720p, I think it would have made a good phone even better. The third con about this phone is that there's no water resistance or dust resistance. So if you are one of those people that often drops their phone in water, or maybe you just want the peace of mind of knowing that you have water resistance, unfortunately, you're not getting that here with the A42 5G. So you better be careful with this phone and make sure that you don't drop it in water or get it too wet. Now, moving on to my fourth least favorite thing about this phone, and that is the bottom bezel. Now, I've certainly seen bottom bezels that are way bigger, but most of those phones are devices that feature LCD displays. Now, one of the benefits with Super AMOLED is that you typically don't need as big of bezels just due to that display technology specifically. So I'm sure they had a reason to make the bottom bezel a little bit bigger, but I really would have liked if they would have given us symmetrical bezels instead. Unfortunately, though, that's not the case, and the bottom bezel is unevenly larger. And then finally, getting into the last thing about this phone that is a shortcoming, but again, not really a deal breaker, and that is that there's no wireless charging. Now, I do appreciate that we are getting that really large 5,000 milliamp hour internal battery, but it would have also been nice to have wireless charging here with the phone, as if you happen to run into an issue with the port on the bottom, for example, then at least you have an alternative method to keep the phone charged up. But also, for certain people, having wireless charging is very convenient. So if you are someone that uses wireless charging quite a bit with your current phone, then just know that you're not getting it here with the A42 5G. But I hope you enjoyed this pros and cons video about the Samsung Galaxy A42 5G. I'm really curious to know what you think about my analysis of the device, and if you agree or disagree on certain things. Again, just to clarify, in general, I think this is a good phone that does pack in quite a bit of value, but those five things that I went over at the end are shortcomings that could be very important to certain people. But I hope you enjoyed the video, and I will see you in the next one.